If we take a look to the saving rates, and if you take a look to the efforts of commercial banks regarding grasping more and more savings from population, we can see that this activity was quite diminished in the last years. Commercial banks being more interested to obtain financing, cheap money from financing, like cheap money from central bank. So my question is the following. Do you think that in this world, the commercial bank activities are related to the private market or to the public market? They are private or public institutions, commercial banks?
In a way, by having become part of a banking cartel that is only made possible by the existence of a central bank, they have become, at least to a certain extent, public institutions and are no longer pure private institutions. The activity that banks engage in are to a large extent activities that in a free market would be considered to be illegal activities. And only public institutions can, of course, engage in such activities. What governments do in general is engage in activities that private citizens are not allowed to do. Government taxes you, that would be in the dealings between private citizens, would be considered to be stealing from you. Governments engage in activities like taxing and then redistributing income. In the dealings between private citizens, this activity would be called stealing and fencing off stolen goods. So what commercial banks do is they partly engage in activities that would also exist on the free market, and they take in the savings of savers and loan these savings out. But to a large extent, of course, they loan out things and earn interest on things that are not the result of anybody's savings, but of, in private law dealings, criminal activities undertaken by the central bank. So they cannot be clearly classified as falling into either this category or in that. They are a crazy mixture of thoughts.
Okay, any other questions? Until you warm up, I will have a question for Professor Hoppe. It is a big issue in Lithuania today, this international monetary fund assistance that we might need. It is not supposed to be necessary in order for us not to get into deeper trouble or to get out of trouble. What would your opinion be on such an institution and such a type of assistance?
Because these institutions are also set up by governments in order to stand ready to bail out whoever needs to be bailed out out of financial difficulties, which are the result of the same policies that all central banks all over the world pursue and in which they are assisted by the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund. In a way, these institutions, what they do is always try to reward governments that have pursued a particularly bad economic policy and thereby assure that these miserable economic policies will be continued. The same thing that you see going on in the Greek case. If a normal firm would go bankrupt, what would they have to do? assets, the governments would have to be entirely liquidated. All of the things that the governments own would have to be sold off into private hands. If that would happen, a miracle, an economic miracle would break out in Greece, because all the hundreds of thousands of public employees who currently produce things that nobody wants, that nobody is voluntarily willing to pay for the first time in their life, have to look for a productive occupation and stand on their own feet, would have to join the productive population instead of being part of a parasitic class. That would be a short, big shock for Greece, but after half a year or a year, I think Greece would be out of this crisis. Institutions such as International Monetary Fund, World Banks, they are only set up in order to prevent precisely these things from happening. The bankruptcy of the state would be magnificent. Nobody ever would loan any money to an institution such as this. People who have done it once and are not being paid back their debts will not commit this same mistake once again. So a great effort undertaken to rescue Greece and then Spain and then Italy. In the end, it will lead to a bankruptcy of Germany that is supposed to bail these guys out. And create an even bigger crisis, because once Germany declares bankruptcy, then how will they solve this problem? They will solve this problem by printing even more money than they ever printed before, and by clamoring for instituting a world central bank, not just the US Central Bank and the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank, but the European Central Bank. Now then they will demand we must have a world central bank issuing a world paper currency, because then we have unlimited abilities of creating money out of thin air. In the current world, the situation is still such that if the United States prints continuously in dollars, then the US dollar will fall in the currency market against other currencies, the EU, the euro, for instance. Europe is still controlled by the United States. Europe is, so to speak, a satellite of the United States. The European Central Bank takes orders from the Central Bank of the United States. Of course, they will not tell you that they do what they do. But there are still some countries like China and so forth that are not dominated in this way. And there is, of course, a danger that if the euro continuously devalues and the US dollar devalues and the Chinese yuan will rise, that limits the ability of the United States and of the European countries to inflate at will. If all national currencies are abolished and there's only one world paper currency, then you will see inflation as you have never seen it before in your life. So all of these institutions, as far as I'm concerned, should be abolished. Money should be produced on the market like every other good, subject to supply and demand constraints and so forth. All monopolies should be abolished.
Okay. Is there another question? Any question?
I understand some of our grounds are when this is executed. I have a question for you. It is a recent trend about sovereign wealth funds. Sovereign wealth funds basically are state-owned investment funds that feed off earnings or revenues from state-owned companies that were nationalized and create boom and bust cycles in the international marketplace. what's your position on that?
No, I don't think the movement must cycle these causes as far as I know. These sovereign wealth funds are just simply a means of governments to use their tax revenues to invest in various businesses and hope for an interest return and be able to pay, for instance, for pension obligations and similar things. So I think the sovereign wealth funds, I do not consider them to be a major danger. I wish, for instance, Germany would have a sovereign wealth fund. Country like Norway, for instance, has a sovereign wealth fund. Imagine that you have social security systems like in all Western countries, where the pensions of the people are paid by currently working employees. Pensions are not paid by people having saved up and then drawing down their savings when they are old. Old people get paid by people who are currently employed. If you have what you have in most Western countries, that is to say, life expectancy continuously increases, birth rates continuously decline, you can already anticipate that there will be a major catastrophe building up, in the sense that they cannot reap, that they cannot pay the pensions that they are obliged to pay. I think some countries, at least in the Norwegian case, that seems to be the case, they build up these funds in order to be able to pay their obligations to pensioners when they can no longer do it out of the contributions that the current workforce is paying. So I must say there might be different forms of organizing these sovereign wealth funds in different countries. That I do not know what the specific differences are in various countries, but I do not from the outset see a particular problem in sovereign wealth funds. In a way, it's an attempt on the part of criminal organizations to be a little bit responsible organizations, instead of spending all money on current consumption, they invest some of it somewhere in the hope that they will be productively used, repaid, plus interest and so forth. So again, I'm not an expert on the construction of sovereign wealth funds. I would not bet my life on the correctness of this answer, but that is my impression.
Okay, we have another question over there. And then?
So, good evening. My name is Nicola Marian, so small difference from the France president. And I have a question about the news I reached 2 days ago about a possibility of army intervention in Iran. It was a news release from the Israeli Prime Minister about an army intervention, a military intervention in Iran. What's your opinion about the changes that occur the United States or Europe or Israel to come to Iran? And we want the currency, the dollar to Europe.
Yeah, then the pressure to engage in inflationary policies will cause an increase. They would have to fund these things. They would have to indebt themselves even more. I might make the general point that central banks have, one of the reasons for central banks having been set up was that that governments could more easily go to war. Look, wars must be funded. They must be financed. How can you finance it? You can ask the public to give you the money for it. So you can try to sell government bonds to the public. You can try to raise taxes. This all takes time, and the outcome is not certain. So you might decide, I can't go to war because I can't get the funding for it. If you have an institution that can simply print it up, as I said, we lower the reserve requirements from 10% to 5%, you can double the money supply in one day. Then of course you can go to war. You can just pay salaries to the soldiers, buy tanks from the army suppliers, and so forth. So central banks are also dangerous institutions, even in this sense, that they make increase the likelihood of countries engaging in military adventures. Unfortunately, I'm quite concerned about this threat against Iran that we hear about, and this is one of the techniques that governments have used. They are in deep trouble financially and so forth. What is the best thing in order to draw attention away from this crisis? The best way is to create an even bigger crisis, because then everybody will of course talk, or will the Israelis use nuclear weapons? Will the Americans use nuclear weapons? Yeah, then the dangers that I described, inflation, state bankruptcies, and so on, they become minor problems as compared with the problem that is brewing there. So governments love crises, frequently fabricate the crises in order to increase their power still further. The Iraq war. Obviously, Iraq had absolutely nothing to do with this 9/11 event. Nothing whatsoever. It did not have any weapons of mass destruction. It was just all a huge lie. Everybody knows it in the meantime. But the fact that 9/11 happened was, of course, a magnificent event for Bush, because he wanted to go to war before the public opinion was against it. Now you just have to just invent some little stories. Iraq, Saddam Hussein, they had something to do. Al-Qaeda, who knows, it met them somewhere. And all Americans then are gung-ho about doing this sort of thing. I think the reports that the Atomic Energy Committee came out about Iran is on the verge of having a nuclear bomb. Who funds the Atomic Energy Commission? The main funders is the United States, and I'm sure Israel also funded the report. So they knew already what the report would say, and they want to have a report like this in order to create a crisis. There are numerous examples like this in history. We know, for instance, that President Roosevelt knew, because they had broken the secret code of Japan, that there was an impending attack of the Japanese Air Force on Pearl Harbor. But he did not warn the commanders in Hawaii that was going to happen. He wanted it to happen, because then he had the perfect excuse to enter World War II, which he always had planned to do, couldn't do without some event taking place, because the public opinion in the United States was opposed to it. As soon as Pearl Harbor happened, of course, they were all in favor of it. So I have, in many, many years of observing political events, I have come to the conclusion, first, whenever you hear some official statement, responsible government people, first thing, it's probably not true, either it's because the people are dumb or they lie, unless there is clear-cut proof
than it is, in fact, the truth. When you adopt this type of internal policy, by and large, you will find out that you tend to be right. Never without reservations accept what you are told by responsible governmental organizations. Most likely it is not true. They also, your savings are safe. In my savings are not safe. We have everything under control. Germany is capable of handling these types of crises. Yeah, this is all a bunch of nonsense sought to just persuade the population that the governments in all countries continuously try to dumb down. The last question,
Hello, my name is Alex. And, following the logic of your scheme and of the money scheme, and assuming that history repeats, I think that hyperinflation is unavoidable, at least in the US dollar, maybe a global one. Some economists think that in 2012 we'll see hyperinflation, and in 2013 we'll see the first beginning of the signs of hyperinflation. When do you think it's going to happen? And the second question, if you invest in precious metals?
Okay, I have invested in precious metals for quite some time. I bought a sizable amount of gold when the gold prices were very low. That has turned out to be the best of my investments that I made. I'm not a good investor, I promise, but that I could see. It's like, if you want to be a good investor, you have to follow the papers on a daily level. That's not my style. But I could see that since 1971, when the last tied gold was eliminated and the entire world adopted pure paper money standards, that paper monies are in the long run a bad investment, and saw that gold was a good way to protect yourself against. There were also times when the gold investment looked bad. So it was drastic fall in gold prices. So it depends a little bit also on your time horizon that you have. I mean, if you only live for 5 more years, you might think differently about it. On the other hand, if you have a longer time horizon, I think also who my kids inherit from me, then I saw that it was a wise investment and it turned out to be true. What was the first?
When the inflation
is already happening. It's like all of these inflation numbers that you get, they always take out those things where prices go up more, they drop them out of the basket for which they calculate, and those things where prices fall, they add them into the basket. There exist alternative ways of calculating. There are some people have published statistics based simply on the way inflation rates were measured 10 or 15 years ago, and they say, based on that, there would be inflation rates already now of 10 or 15%. I do not think that they are out to create hyperinflation, because hyperinflation is, of course, the end of this type of system. So hyperinflation, they do want to prevent under all circumstances, because hyperinflation means the central bank is powerless, can't do anything anymore. Nobody will take this paper, people will go back to barter, to barter central bank who says we should now create hyperinflation. But the X inflation going on, we have not had a single year without any inflation, sometimes more, sometimes less. And you can see there are in the United States in the last few months again, there's a drastic increase in the money supply taking place. And the new head of the European Central Bank, Mr. Draghi, was before a banker for Goldman Sachs. So it's always important to find out what did these people do before, what will they do after they are out of their job. So Mr. Draghi is also the tool of the Americans, a tool of Goldman Sachs. Goldman Sachs is, so to speak, the most influential investment company in the United States. In every American administration, government administration, there are Goldman Sachs people in there. And these banking elites have their puppets in all parts. For them, it doesn't matter whether the Republicans win or the Democrats win. Regardless of who wins, there will be Goldman Sachs and similar type people sitting in their administration and telling them what to do. Mr. Obama's power, and Mr. Clinton's power, and Mr. Bush's power is frequently overestimated. There are people in the background that are far more powerful than these figures. These people in the background laugh about the stupidity of those people that are their central figures that appear in the public and pretend that they are the ones who make the major decisions. They have people surrounding them who see to it that they make the decisions that the major banking houses come to be made. Thank you.